Good evening and welcome to the Carmel City Council Finance Committee meeting tonight. Noting the presence of a quorum, I'm calling this meeting to order. My name is Sue Finkham. I'm chair of the Carmel Finance Committee. I'm elected to represent the northeast part of Carmel. Also serving on the Finance Committee are Bruce Kimball, Miles Nelson, and Jeff Worrell. Additionally, joining us tonight from the City Council are Adam Austin, Council President Laura Campbell, Tony Green, Tim Hannon, and Kevin Ryder. This is a second of three special meetings initially scheduled to discuss only the financing and governance of building the Hotel Carmichael per resolution CC-0302-2001. After the three meetings, the Finance Committee with input from the rest of the council will decide if additional information is necessary, and if so, if additional meetings are necessary, or if another way of getting that information is adequate. Once a committee deems it has all the relevant information it needs, it will solicit input from all councilors, whether it be on the Finance Committee or the rest of the council, to suggest recommendations and make a summary report. And that report will be provided at a future council meeting. I've chosen to break up these initial three meetings as follows. Yesterday, we discussed the powers provided by the state to the CRC, the work the CRC did in developing the initial estimate that was presented to council for approving the project, and the difference between what an estimate is and what a formal project budget is. Tonight, we're going to discuss what elements are of the hotel deal that was presented to council for our approval and review, and also the bidding and construction process that the Hotel Carmichael underwent. Thursday, we will focus on the actions the CRC took to fund the hotel once it was clear the hotel budget far exceeded the initial estimate. So due to the challenge of multiple speakers at multiple times, I'm going to run the meeting asking a majority of the questions. When I've concluded, or around 7:10 p.m., whichever comes first, I will open it up to the committee and council for questions. Per my customary way of leading a committee meeting, I'll allow one question from each of the committee members first, and then we'll open up to the rest of the council members that are on the call tonight. And if we have time, we'll go around and ask for additional questions if there are any. Councilors, I ask once again, please keep your questions brief so we can get everybody's questions in. And if you don't have any questions when it's your time, just please say pass or let me know in the chat box if you don't have a question, and that'll keep the meeting moving along. As last night, it's my intention to try to end the meeting around 7:30 p.m. or close to it as I can. It's now time in the agenda to read the public comments received. And I'd like to take a moment, if you didn't weren't with us last night, to say we do have public comment form available on the carmel.in.gov site. If you go to that site, navigate to the Carmel City Council page, there's a link there on the top of that page where you can click through, fill out a form with your comments. It comes to us in email, and then I can read them at these meetings. All of our comments are limited to 3 minutes. So these are all short, so I don't have any concern about them going over 3 minutes, but should one have been lengthy, we would have cut it at 3 minutes per our council rules. The first one is from Greg Fay. He is a property owner in Carmel and Clay Township, and he's speaking in opposition. And the comments are as follows. Only is there a laundry in the hotel to handle internal cleaning of items like bed linens? How did a high-end hotel get designed without room for couches in the rooms, requiring major costly design changes later? Council approved $40 million, I thought, inclusive of debt costs for the hotel, but $43 million was borrowed. Who approved the increase? Banks require supporting documentation for loaning money. What documents were given to support the underestimated debt need? How did a city employee have the ability to take on $18.5 million in city debt without council approval? Who approved and who signed for this debt? Isn't there a state law regarding redevelopment commissions only having the ability to take on up to $2 million in debt via bond anticipation notes without council approval? Who is paying the current operating expenses of the hotel? From the presentations, the increase has been known for over a year. Why didn't either of the council representatives on the CRC bring this to the council and the public? Next up is Ed Shaughnessy. Ed is also a property owner in Carmel in Clay Township. His comments are, testimony from Sheil Sexton and Paul Corey Tuesday seemed to indicate that the CRC was not prepared, that they did not have adequate skills necessary to enter the building of a hotel. Presenting six pieces of paper is not adequate to present to a builder. Anyone who has done a home construction project also knows that change request is expensive and indicative of poor planning. The CRC should have left this project to the private sector, but the hospitality experts knew this project was not viable, despite what the mayor and the CRC told us in 2017. And the last comment is from Christine Pauly, who is also a property owner here in Carmel and Clay Township. The City of Carmel and the Carmel Redevelopment Commission issued a request for municipal financing dated November 3rd, 2017. Please note the date of November 3rd, 2017. In the document, schematics were provided and various partners were listed, including cash flows, a pro forma budget, and a Shiel Sexton conceptual estimate dated September 11, 2017. The Shiel estimates were very detailed in outlining the projected expenditures within each building trade, from roofing, concrete, metals, to even allowances for the Feinstein Club and landscaper plants and mulch. My question is in regard to the transparency of the public bids, Shiel Sexton's bid summaries, and contracts were awarded. Where can the public view these documents and contracts? Laserfish, provide specific cost versus budgeted, specifically CSI Level 5, which allowed for the build of the Feinstein Club with kitchen, library, lounge, restaurant, bar, painting, and wall coverings, as listed on pages 1 through 6 of the RFP, where the conceptual estimate exceeded the actual costs. We are going to go over the bidding tonight. We'll get some of these questions answered. We're going to go over a little bit of the financing tonight as it relates to the initial deal and the partners involved. And then we're also going to go over the equity that was brought in after it was determined that additional dollars were needed to fund the actual cost of the hotel budget. But if this were a committee meeting, we're all sitting around a table like we normally do, or we're in the council chambers, before we had to take these meetings virtual, we would have had more of a back and forth conversation with counselors and with the public. So at this time, what I'd like to do is at least offer Henry Mastetsky the opportunity to respond to any of the comments or questions he heard here, asking though that he not cover something that's going to be covered later on in the evening or tomorrow night. Henry, would you like to respond to anything on these?
Thank you, Councillor. Henry Mastetsky, Carmel Redevelopment Commission Executive Director. Sure, I'll take a quick stab at answering some of these. The first question from Ms. Pauly, she references a conceptual estimate that Shiel Sexton did. Obviously, a conceptual estimate is something you do before you really see the drawings, before the drawings really get fleshed out. So it's something that Shiel Sexton came up with based on, you know, their best guess without really seeing the drawings, really beyond what we talked about all day yesterday. As far as transparency, yeah, you can go on Laserfish and you can see all the public bidding documents that came out. So all that is out there. Mr. Shaughnessy's question about if you're doing home construction, don't you know what you're going to build and how much it's going to cost? And the answer is, I mean, yes, when you're doing something like a home, that's true. This isn't like a home. It's not even like a multi-million dollar home. This is the cost of designing this thing is multi-millions of dollars. And so all day yesterday, we discussed how much money do you spend on design without knowing that the council is going to approve the project. And obviously my predecessor did what she did, and that's what happened. But no, it's not like you're going to spend millions and millions of dollars to design the whole thing so the costs can be locked in before you know the project is going to be approved. That gentleman's question about the public or the private sector doesn't want to do this. Hey, the private sector came to us with hotel ideas all the time, and they were willing to build the Days Inn. They were not willing, this hotel is going to make a return, but not a return that's high enough for some of these private sector companies to put a hotel on this site that had to be the city's landmark hotel, the anchor hotel to our downtown. You know, private developers, by investing an extra $1 million into the facade that complements our downtown and serves as the backdrop for our skating rink in the wintertime, adjacent to the Carmichael, or adjacent to the Palladium, for example, that extra $1 million in the facade does not return $1 million in net revenue for the private sector. That's the reason public-private partnerships exist in the first place. I think that this gentleman would have also asked, why did we build a Palladium and not a movie theater there? He's allowed to have those opinions. I just disagree with them. We have a fundamental misunderstanding or a fundamental difference in what it means to build a new downtown from scratch, and how to use leverage public-private partnerships to get something that benefits everybody in the whole city and serves an economic development function for the whole city. The first gentleman had a bunch of questions. There's a washer and dryer on site to do small items, but generally the laundry operation is farmed out. Linens from beds is going to be shipped to one location, and table service is going to be shipped to another location because you don't wash those things together. Rooms, how does addition to adding a couch to the room, why would you do this? It's so incredibly costly. Something like that would have been done during design development. And so that's only done when you're, you know, still putting conceptual things, design development, drawings on paper. It would not have cost that much to put that out there at that point. Borrowing, we get into that tomorrow. Banks require documentation. That's correct. How does a city employee take on debt? If you're referring to me, I think it's a question of how does the Redevelopment Commission generally borrow? And I think we'll get into, we talked about some of that yesterday, and we'll talk about it tomorrow, so I'm not going to address it here. Who's funding current operations? Obviously, the loan and the bonds in this hotel have closed. The hotel is almost a going concern. It's ready to open. And part of the closing of those loans funded a operating account for kind of startup operating expenses, and that's where that money's coming out from. A question about bond anticipation notes. We didn't use bond anticipation notes on this deal, so I'm not sure that's relevant. I think that covers everything.
Great, thank you very much. Moving into tonight's focus, can a member of the CRC or its attorney review the elements of the hotel deal presented to council for approval when we saw it in fall of 2017? And I'd like you to explain who the partners were, what equity was brought, what was the lending, what was the overall deal structure, including the development of a municipal corporation, also its members and their titles.
Let me see if I can share my screen real quick, because I think that would be helpful here. One moment. I'm gonna do my best to do this. So sorry everyone. Okay, what does everyone see? Do you see a chart?
We see, you need to minimize the screen that you're moving right now.
Do you see a chart now?
Yes.
That says ownership structure?
Yes.
Okay. Is that the only thing you see? I mean, is it just a big PowerPoint that takes up, or a big PDF that takes up the screen?
Those viewing at home also see you in a little box in the corner, and then see everybody involved on the call on the right.
Okay, great. All right, so I'll give a kind of initial overview. So this is a public-private partnership. It includes the Redevelopment Commission, and it includes our partner, Petcor, on this deal. So there's a piece of land. That land is owned by an entity owned by our partner, Petcor. This is the land. It's owned by our partner, Petcor, one of their entities, and it's owned by a community development corporation. On that land sits the hotel itself through what's called a ground lease. That ground lease tenant, that's the hotel itself. That's how we think about that. The reason to do this structure is so that the hotel itself is a private entity. and it pays taxes, it pays property taxes, it pays into the TIF area because it's owned by a private entity. It can get mortgaged so that you can take out a private loan. But the control of that private tenant, and to a certain extent, revenue coming from that tenant, can be divided by, can be split between the Redevelopment Commission and their, essentially the Redevelopment Commission and the private, and our partner PEDCOR. So the way for a Redevelopment Commission to partner with a private entity to do a hotel where the hotel itself pays taxes and can get mortgaged and is a private entity ultimately, this is the way to do it. So the private tenant, the hotel itself, it's the one that gets the private financing. And remember, everyone, that this deal has a bond component where the city put in dollars into the hotel through the CRC. And this hotel has a loan component where our private partner, the hotel, went out and got a loan. So on this chart, our private partner, the hotel itself, goes out, gets a loan, has to repay the loan. The Redevelopment Commission, because of the bonds that the council gave it, puts those bonds into the Community Development Corporation, the CDC, and the CDC puts those bonds into the hotel. So the bonds and the loans together is how you generally get the financing for the hotel. The Carmel Redevelopment Commission itself, initially, when this whole first thing was getting started, took on the architectural contract, the engineering contract, branding, interior design contract. So those services were contributed by the Redevelopment Commission to the project as the hotel is being built. And once the hotel is running, you know, the hotel manager that manages the operation of the hotel works for the and is contracted with the hotel building, if you will. Let's just call it that. The franchise agreement with Marriott is also with the hotel tenant, the building itself, and the construction services offered by Shiel Sexton are ultimately with the hotel tenant. So this is the private entity. It earns revenue. The city, through the CRC, has an interest in it. And to have some control over this tenant, that control is managed through the lease between the building itself and the land that it sits on, and that land is owned by our partner PEDCOR and the Community Development Corporation at the center of this together. That is essentially the structure. Ryan, feel free to jump in if you want to add anything to it.
thank you, Henry. Happy to just kind of supplement some of that, just to go through, I guess, a little bit more of the detail that was, as I understand it, presented to the Council Finance Committee and then later the full council in 2017. And just to remind everyone that neither Henry nor I was directly involved, so we're kind of going off of what we have, what
unknown
we have seen.
Unknown participant is now joining.
So generally speaking, the what was presented to council and what was actually done is very much consistent. The primary parties to the DLR, CRC, and Downtown City Center Community Development Corporation on the city side, and then PEDCOR with the PEDCOR TIC owner and the PEDCOR ground tenant.
TIC owner is the land. When Ryan says TIC owner, that's the land. That's entities own the land.
Thank you, Henry. TIC meaning tenant in common. So the two TIC owners or tenants in common are the fee title holders to the project site. They're the ones who have ground leased the site to the ground tenant, the boutique hotel entity that operates the hotel. Marriott, it was promised to be a Marriott autograph hotel and a Marriott approved hotel operator. Of course, we have that, and the hotel operator being Corey Hospitality. CRC has the primary, or at least co-design and construction direction rights. So everything that happens with respect to the hotel is through CRC directly, notwithstanding the fact that technically it's the CDC that is the that has the TIC interest here. CRC is the one directly that's actually directing the construction, the development, the design. The construction loan was stated in 2017 to be approximately $25 million. In reality, when we actually closed in 2019, that number was the total between the construction loans was $25.5 million, so a $500,000 increase there. The TIC owners, the tenants and common owners, did mortgage the hotel site, and the ground tenant, the hotel owner, mortgaged its ground lease interest to the lender so that they've got a mortgage in the fee and the leasehold. CRC did enter into a grant agreement as a backup to the construction loans. That's assigned then to the lender, which I suspect we will cover either later today or tomorrow. In terms of maybe some slight differences, the I believe that at least the what was presented to the finance committee in 17 may have said that CRC would enter into the hotel operating or management agreement. That's not the case. Of course, it's the hotel tenant, the ground tenant that actually entered into that agreement in 2019. Same thing with perhaps some of the construction contracts. I think there may have been some statements in there that it would be CRC entering in the construction contracts. Again, that was the ground tenant, just to clarify, using the full bidding, public bidding requirements that are applicable to the CRC. In 2017, as I read the materials, there was a statement that perhaps CRC would enter into the grant agreement with the PEDCOR ground tenant as the hotel owner. That's not the way it's set up. I think that was a typo at the time. The CRC was always intended to enter into a grant agreement with the CDC, the municipal CDC partner.
So and a grant agreement is the means by which, when the council authorized bonds to go to the Redevelopment Commission, the grant agreement is the means by which the Redevelopment Commission puts the bonds into the hotel deal.
Thank you.
Clarify.
Thank you. I know there was a statement about the bond proceeds being $15 million. That was later increased to $18 million. I don't know, Henry, if I mean, presumably the council has approved all that, but I don't know if you wanted to add any color to that change.
When I came on board, I saw that there were $18 million allocated for the money to put into the hotel. And so that's what was done.
Okay, thank you. And then finally, the only other, it was really kind of a minor difference. What was presented to what I believe was the full council in November of 17 was that the CRC and its staff and consultants, I think, assumed that banks would prefer a municipal type loan or construction loans, as opposed to your more traditional real estate type loans. What I mean by that is the underwriting for those loans is done primarily by some municipal entity, in this case, the CRC, whereas a more traditional real estate type loan would be a real estate mortgage, and that's what the primary collateral and underwriting is. That had been the case for about a decade, where banks more or less preferred that to keep certain types of loans off their balance sheets, and they didn't necessarily like real estate loans for a while. Those had kind of fallen out of favor after the market crash in 2008. So for a long time, they were municipal type loans. What ended up happening, of course, is when we went out to place these, banks responded that they preferred real estate loans now, a more traditional mortgage type. So that was the primary collateral. Again, both the fee and the ground lease were mortgaged as collateral for the loan, and CRC's grant agreement, grant obligation, was just a backstop to that. So kind of a minor change from what the full council would have seen in 2017. The structure itself is essentially the same. But just in terms of the type of loan was slightly different. Otherwise, I think Henry covered everything.
Yeah, so if I could just add, if anyone is just joining this late, ultimately, the goal here was how do you put city investment in a hotel that protects it and that gives you something other than, look, you just gave them a bunch of money, right? You had Indianapolis doing deals with the Conrad, with the JW, and these kind of deals are done across the country where the city puts money into hotels. And maybe after I speak here, maybe Paul, who is probably joining us again, can chime in on that. But I think the intent here presented to council was always something different. Instead of just giving a nice hotel a bunch of money and say, here you go, be nicer than what the market would otherwise build, we decided to do something where the long-term payoff comes back to the city, where that ownership, that investment comes back to the city. And so by doing a structure where we're our partner PEDCOR entity and a community development corporation team up to own the land on which the land leases the building, and this is a private entity that pays taxes that can get mortgaged, that pays into the TIF. The result of that is when this hotel has 2-3 years of operations and is ready to be bought by the private sector, you just sell this entity off, a private sector purchases it, and the revenue from that, the proceeds from that come back to the CDC partner and eventually back to the commission or back to the city. In addition, this is a way to have a totally private building that pays taxes, that can take on a mortgage, sit there while control and revenue from the hotel can come back again to our partner PEDCOR to be split between our partner PEDCOR and the Community Development Corporation. So how do you spin this off to get the taxpayers the most bang for their buck instead of just giving away money, but making an actual investment? This is the structure. How do you make it as easy as possible to sell this off to the private sector in the couple years for the money to come back to the city based on its investment? This is the structure. And generally, this was pretty much what was presented to council on day one. So I can take this chart off, Councillor Finkham, if you'd like me to.
Just a second, please.
Okay.
So one of our counselors asked, who are the partners in the CCC Boutique Hotel LLC and what's the equity split? That was asked by Councillor Hannon.
Right. Okay. So again, if an entity is owned by a municipal entity, if the CRC owns a hotel and puts it on a piece of land, that hotel pays no taxes. That building can't get mortgaged. You can't just spin it off easily. You can't sell it. So the goal was always, how do you build a hotel that is a going concern and just sits there, pays taxes, but being one step removed from the CRC or from the city itself? So that's the structure. So the hotel tenant itself is 100% owned by a PEDCOR entity. But the two things that matter, who gets the revenue that the hotel owns, that's passed down to our partner PEDCOR and a community development corporation that is watching out for the CRC. How do you make decisions, control decisions of what this tenant does, right? How do you make that kind of management decision of who to hire or those types of decisions? Who do you want to be your hotel manager, for example? That decision-making happens between our partner PEDCOR and the Redevelopment Commission. And so This was the structure that was presented by the firm Wallach, Summers, and Haas, specifically Carl Haas, who had been the attorney for the Redevelopment Commission for 20 years since the mayor first engaged him and when the mayor first formed the Redevelopment Commission. Unfortunately, we lost Carl about 2 weeks into when I first became director. It was incredibly sad. The man had put in his blood, sweat, and tears into growing our downtown. And I think we think of this as kind of the last vestiges of the greatness that Carl kind of put forward, is this structure where we have the control, we have the revenue collection, we are able to spin this off, but ultimately the hotel itself is a private entity that can take on loans, that can take on mortgages, that pays taxes. Paul, how often do you see these types of deals that are not structured this way, where it's mostly the city just giving money away? If you're on.
Yeah, I'm here.
And Paul, to give your name and title, because we are having this transcribed, please.
Okay, great. Paul Corey, chairman of Corey Hospitality. Well, the transactions that I have been involved with municipalities and or bid on typically are incentive packages. They don't typically, you know, invest side by side as a partner. Although I did do a similar type structure to this, not exactly, but with the municipality in Texas. And they had the same thinking that you do, and that is, you know, why just give incentives and money away and then it inures to the benefit of the developer versus we can put our money in with the developer and benefit from it when cash is distributed and or it sells. And so I think that this is probably a little bit more progressive, but also a way that a lot of the cities look at new buildings, because as we know with historical buildings, there are incentives out there to help those to justify them through tax credits and different mechanisms. So I think this was a good approach in terms of trying to, you know, get capital back at some point.
Thank you. And I know that the Indy Star, the IBJ have covered extensively the incentive packages that the city of Indianapolis has put into the Conrad and to the JW Hotel. And they're not 50-50 deals. They're not, they're more an incentive. And then maybe you get some small percentage in the future and you don't have control. You don't have any of that. And I think, again, the reason for something like this is because Carmel, the city of Carmel and its partner Pedcor built something that the Urban Land Institute has called a booming neighborhood, a booming part of the city, our central core, from scratch on some farmland. And it's been the vision of the councils and the mayor and our partner Pedcor to invest here and to build this from scratch. And this landmark hotel is a testament to what the city has done. And once it's got a couple of years of operation, we get to sell it. We get to realize on that revenue and continue to invest in our central core and continue to grow it.
Thank you, Henry. Could you give us a little more information on the structure of the Downtown City Center Development Corporation? What powers are provided to it by the state of Indiana and why it doesn't have day-to-day oversight, like you said, the CRC does with the CCC Hotel Land LLC?
Ryan, you want to take the first one, and I'll take the second question. The powers that community development corporations have under state statute, and I'll take on this specific one here.
Yes, happy to do so. The a CDC is a nonprofit corporation. It's organized under the laws of the state of Indiana, which generally then give it all the rights and powers and authorities that most for-profit, that any for-profit company would have. Of course, there are certain restrictions that it has to be nonprofit. And this particular, the CDCs at least that with which the CRC has partnered in the past, including the Downtown City Center Development Corporation, are set up specifically, organized in the Articles of Incorporation as a public benefit corporation, which simply means it is organized for public and or charitable purposes. The Downtown City Center Development Corporation specifically was formed to support and further the charitable, educational, and other public purposes of the city. With that, it means simply that, and actually specifically calls out the relationship and partnership with the CRC, cites the redevelopment statute for the that sort of symbiotic partnerships that are at least possible between the two, so that grants could be made, say, from CRC to the CDC and vice versa. It is effectively set up to benefit the city and the redevelopment efforts of the city, including but not limited to the CRC.
Can you please describe how the members are appointed, selected, and who they are, please?
Yeah, I could follow up on that. And Bruce Donaldson, are you on? Did you want to add anything to what Ryan has talked about?
Hi, good evening, everyone. Bruce Donaldson with Barnes and Thornburg. I would only add that these CDCs or community development corporations are very frequently used all around the state in conjunction with cities and redevelopment commissions. And they're usually organized as what we call social benefit corporations. One legitimate nonprofit purpose under both Indiana law and federal tax law is to support cities and redevelopment commissions in redevelopment efforts. And that's precisely the type of corporation that this is. And so I've personally been involved in a lot of these around the state where community development corporations are very helpful in helping cities and redevelopment commissions implement their policies.
Thank you, Bruce. The three members that serve on this commission, Jim Winter, and you probably have heard that name before. He's an often citizen volunteer and is a pillar of this community in the city of Carmel, Debbie Buckler and Paul Lucian. And, you know, one of the things that I think we have to consider is and I think many people on this call have probably served on boards, and, you know, the day-to-day operations of organizations are often, you know, they're handled by staff, they're handled by professionals. And it's the role of a community, it's the role of a board to kind of share in the vision and realize on the vision of the mission of the organization and do what they need to do to make sure that organization, you know, is empowered to follow on its mission. So here, the organization's mission here is to, it's to help grow our downtown, help support the city, the redevelopment of the city of Carmel. And, you know, the board members are not, they're not supposed to be day-to-day hotel operators. That's why we have a wonderful hotel manager that deals with that. And they're not supposed to do the kind of things that, you know, Ryan as the attorney, you know, handles. They have to, it's their position to represent the organization, to, you know, meet their fiduciary duties to the organization and ultimately realize on the mission of the organization, which is the growth and prosperity of the city of Carmel and Central Core.
And so thank you for giving us the membership. They're all appointed by the mayor.
That is correct.
Thank you. And then regarding the CRC, there was an outstanding question yesterday with its membership as far as the appointees. Can you go over that as well?
Absolutely.
As far as who appointed them, from what organizations, you went over them, but there was an outstanding question. So if you don't mind repeating that, that'd be helpful.
No, I'm happy to do that. The membership of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission includes three members appointed by the mayor: Bill Hammer, who is a long time but now retired executive for Simon, that, you know, he has been doing these types of deals all over the United States, spent a long time in Washington, D.C., is frankly amazing at this kind of work, and has been here for a long time, I think since 2008, maybe 2006, 2007, and is one of the keys to why our Redevelopment Commission is filled with professionals like these. Longtime president. Yes.
I appreciate the long bio about each one, but if you don't mind, we got a limited time. If you could just give them their name and then who they're appointed by, I appreciate it.
Banker Dave Bowers is the vice president appointed by the city council. retired CEO Bill Brooks, appointed as a secretary, appointed by the mayor. Construction, a person involved in construction named Adam Campagna, appointed by the mayor. Councillor Jeff Worrell, appointed by city council. And Katie Browning, who is a member of the school board and serves on the commission as a non-voting member per state statute.
Thank you. Can you describe in this organizational or ownership structure the revenue split and how that is handled? And then initially how it was presented to council, and then we'll talk tomorrow about if that changed as a result of any decisions made.
Okay, so would you like Ryan to present how this was presented to council initially?
Yep, please. Okay.
Initially, this was presented that the, I'm going to use the term NOI. I'm sure Henry will use it as well. NOI is simply shorthand for net operating income. That's essentially the profit that's available after paying ordinary operating expenses, debt service, property taxes, things of that nature related to the hotel. NOI was to be split between the CRC and PEDCOR, but initially, as presented, the first $7 million of the NOI was going to be used not to go to either CRC or PEDCOR, but to be used to pay down the debt service directly, so that the so that there would be more equity in the project for a refinancing or a sale. Then you'd have more proceeds available, or we would need to borrow less. So with that first $7 million, though, if you, because of the structure, the way it was set up, CRC and PEDCOR, while the are effectively 50-50 partners. Now, the TIC interest, the tenants in common interest, are technically two-thirds, one-third, 66.7% for a downtown city center development corporation, 33.3% for CCC land hotel land. Those are the splits for the as presented, though. That was the split for the first 10 years until this $7 million was paid down. After that, then the split went to 50-50, notwithstanding the difference in the TIC percentages. Okay.
Ultimately, for simplicity's sake, long-term ownership was going to be, revenue was going to be split 50-50.
Right. That's exactly
in perpetuity. Right. And that was what was presented to council.
Yes. So instead of doing, though, the first $7 million and over however many years that would take going to pay down the debt service, of course, half of that benefits PEDCOR as the 50% long-term owner. So if you pay down $7 million, and PEDCOR owns half of that, that's effectively $3.5 million that PEDCOR would realize as a result. Instead, what happened, especially once CRC agreed to increase its equity contribution to fill some of these final gaps on the hotel construction, the parties agreed that for the first 10 years through, I believe it's January of 2031, 75% of the NOI is used to reimburse CRC for that additional equity up to $12 million. And that goes directly to CRC. It doesn't even flow through the downtown CDC. That money actually goes directly, or is supposed to be directly distributed to CRC. The other 25% then is split per the percentages of the tenant in common interest. So 66.7 to CRC, 33.3% to PEDCOR. That's through January of 31. After January of 31, then the NOI 75% continues to pay down that $12 million of additional equity until that $12 million is paid, with the remaining 25% split 50-50. Once CRC receives that $12 million of reimbursement for that additional equity, then all NOI is split 50-50.
I'm gonna try to do this. I'm gonna try to repeat what Ryan said in about 10 seconds here. The initial deal ultimately had the split be 50-50, but a lot of the revenue in the very beginning, CRC was just going to pay off the loan and basically give that to Petcor for no reason. That was the deal that was presented and passed. Because the CRC had to advance new money, which we'll talk about tomorrow, that deal was changed. So now the CRC generally gets its money back before Petcor sees a majority of anything at all. Generally, now CRC is getting paid back. It's $12 to $12.5 million of advancements before Petcor sees very much money at all. Instead of just paying down the loan for no reason to benefit Petcor, but ultimately, at the end of all of that, 50-50 ownership continues just as in the original deal.
Okay, thank you. We'll dive into a little bit more of that tomorrow, I'm sure, as far as how we went from one agreement to the next, but I appreciate that. I'd like to take the next section and break it up into three parts: preparing for bidding, and financing the construction start. Can the Shields Sexton team describe what steps took place after the council approved the hotel in the fall of 2017 to finalize the hotel design so bidding could occur? And along with that, well, we'll stop there. We'll keep it. What happened to get us from the estimate that we talked about yesterday of $40 million, where the council approved the organizational structure, the ownership structure that we saw, the $40 million estimate to move forward to now bid the project? What work had to occur, and how long did it take up until the point we were ready to bid?
Can I just jump in here for a second? So there are two things that are happening here. One is the hotel owners are going through architecture, going through design, interior design, getting ready to submit ultimately drawings that are ready to bid on one hand. And on the other hand, Shields Sexton, as they're receiving final ready for construction drawings, are taking those out to bid. And because we went in four different packages, there's overlap here. So maybe better that I talk about on the design side, what happened from the council meeting to get us to be ready to bid. And then Shields Sexton takes over and discusses the actual bidding procedures and how that happened. However you'd like, Counselor.
That's fine, Henry. Just if you could keep it somewhat brief, because we really want to dig into the bidding part, but I appreciate the overview of the design because I do think it is helpful.
Thank you. I'll do this fairly quickly. After council generally approved the deal, the hotel owners started entering into contracts with our interior designers, take on our architect full on. The architect starts bringing on its consultants. That's kind of happening in late 2017. Again, council approved the bond in September 2017. GSB, our architect, I'll just say architect, issues around November 2017 schematic designs. What that means generally is, here's your floor plans. We basically think that these are the rooms. Remember, on this deal, we have an architect that is responsible for everything except what's exactly inside the rooms or inside the hallways. And we have a separate interior designer that's doing, what do you see when you're actually walking around inside? So those are two different professionals serving those functions. So schematic design came out in about November 2017. That's basically, hey, here's the rooms, here's the space. We basically, it's a very basic notion. Everyone kind of agrees with that. Design development begins in the next few months. Design development is everyone has agreed to basically what the spaces are. Now let's figure out how mechanical fits in there. Let's figure out how plumbing, let's figure out how electric fits in there. It's less conceptual. And now before we actually draw this on paper, let's figure out how these different systems fit in. That's when you get, that's when you get those professionals on board to start going through that. Around the same time, the interior designer really starts doing that work. So that's all happening through, at the end of 2017, beginning of 2018. That's around that area is when, as Paul Corey talked about yesterday, that's when the size of the hotel expanded from about 104,000 square feet to about 112,000 square feet. Around March of 2018 is when design development was done. So then everybody flew into the city of Carmel, and we did a two-day session on figuring out, making sure everything fits together. A bunch of professionals sit around the room and do that. During this time, this is when interior design continues to do their work. They actually came in around May of 2018 and presented a bunch of interior design concepts. Everything from here's the trim that's going to be on the wall to these are the fabrics in the rooms. This is the kind of furniture we're envisioning. So that happened around May 2018. That happened around April 2018 and May 2018. We kind of figured out what those concepts were. You know, the professionals had been working for, you know, half a year on this stuff at this point. That's when the team flew to Bethesda to get Marriott's kind of initial approval on this project and a buy-in on how that was going. Probably around, this is kind of where the tariffs start hitting. We're kind of, by July, we're in 50% construction document stage. So when you go from design development to construction documents, you go from, you know, everybody working together to get these designs figured out to actually construction documents, which is what you bid from. You take that out to the professional, to the contractors, and those are the documents that they use to actually provide bids. And it takes some time to go from design development to construction documents. We bid this project in different stages, right? We did four packages ultimately. And the general reason for that is because, you know, Marriott or anyone doing a hotel, they want you to open in the spring. They want you to take advantage of, you know, spring weather, summer weather, especially here in Indiana. You better be up and running by Indy 500 if you want to build a hotel. And so because we were dealing with, on bid package one, for example, these long lead items like steel, we went out and separated the packages to knock out the long lead items so that we weren't holding on to do the entire thing and run smack into the middle of winter. So as Shield was doing, even starting on the bidding for some of the early release packages, the interior design was continuing on. As we get into, you know, August of 2018, we have full construction documents generally where, you know, we're putting out August, September of 2018, we're putting out early release packages, some of this stuff. This is, and Sheila will get into this, but it's, you know, it's the steel, it's the concrete. That continues on. Sheila kind of starts mobilizing on the site around October, November. The interior design continues to be worked on during this time. And generally, we have a kind of final interior design happening around the end of 2018, beginning of 2019. And Sheila will talk about this is where a lot of VE is happening as well as these packages are being bid out.
Henry, describe for those who don't know what that means, what VE means.
Sorry. So value engineering, that is where we're tracking the market, and I'm sure Sheila Sexton's going to hit on this, that as all this is happening between 2017 and now we're in 2018 and 2019, the costs, because the market is red hot and everybody's building everything and labor is so scarce, we're tracking these costs beginning to rise up because of essentially the market, right? And so in preparation for that, and Sheila will talk about this, we start doing, before we even bid this out, because ultimately, you don't know what something costs until you bid it out. You can do your best estimating, but it's a public bidding process. And so until it's actually out on the street and you see who shows up with envelopes, with their bids inside the envelopes, and you open those in public, you don't know what something costs. So this is where, while interior design is still going on some of these long lead items, on some things like, you know, the exterior of the building, value engineering is already going on to see how we can cut costs. But ultimately, we close on loans and the bonds around, April of 2019.
Okay, here, because now we're getting past bidding and I want to go back. Can we get Sheila Sexton on to talk about their role in the bidding and how we prepped the packages and got the bid documents ready and did all that? Kevin, are you available?
Yeah. I am, and so is Ryan Schirmersheim and Joe Shanahan. I believe Ryan's going to start this process, but Joe and I are also on, so we're all ready to go and answer questions.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Counselor. I will. I'm looking at the agenda, and I will run through the items and address them accordingly. So I think we're at the – Henry went through the design process, the schematic.
Sir, Ryan, where are you right now?
I'm at the Hotel Carmichael project site.
Thank you. It generally looks better than that. I just want everyone to know that. That's not most of the hotel there in the background.
Right. So as Henry explained, we'll take it from the construction documents and the bidding phase. I think that's the question that I will address. So once we get to the construction documents, we're preparing the bidding documents so that we can issue those documents out to the bidding community and what the owner wants to buy. And really, before we receive those documents, we are already working at developing scopes of work. And what I mean by scopes of work, it's essentially the recipe, what we're asking the bidders to include in their cost proposals. And so that's what I mean by scopes of work. We break down our bid packages, what we call them on this project, for contracts. So what I mean by that, if you can recall, we had contracts such as a masonry contract, drywall framing, the drywall walls. We had a painting contract, all in different bid packages, if you will. So we're building that in the background. I think the first item was the requirements for bidding. So I'd like to speak a little bit of that. As we mentioned, this was a public bid project and the requirements of what that means. And so and these are all state statutes requirements that all bidders need to submit within their proposals that got reviewed upon bid submission. And so there's a bidder's checklist that essentially outlined the items that I'll get into here. There's a state form 96, which is a public works bid form. So that is a requirement that all bidders needed to submit. And then they submit on their individual proposal invoice form. Excuse me. Another requirement was a bid security, a bid bond, if you will. And essentially what that means is similar to the performance bond requirement that we discussed yesterday, the bid bond is essentially a guarantee that the bid's being submitted, that the contractor has to stand, or that insurance, the surety company, is guaranteeing that price, doesn't afford the leverage of that bidder to back out of the bid after they submit. There's some discussion as far as if that issue comes about, an agreement by the owner, if that were to occur. Another requirement is a subcontractor list. If that bidder has any subcontractors working or proposing to be working underneath them, they list those contractors on what we call the subcontract bid list. We spoke about the payment and performance bond yesterday, but that is at the time of bid, at least needs to be a commitment. As we mentioned yesterday, a challenge on the public bid projects or a performance bond and the saturation of the market, that was something that we encountered, that if you're looking at a private project compared to a public project, that was something that was considered as well. And really the last requirement to submit a bid was the E-Verify, basically verifies the employment, the employee's eligibility for working. So that's really what made up in order to bid on this project.
Ryan, does the E-Verify requirement make it easier to find qualified responders or harder? Or what does it do to the costs?
Yeah, it's another layer. And frankly, not all projects require that. I think your question, it does drive up costs similar to, the bid security bonds and the performance bond requirements. So, there's just another layer that is was a requirement on this project. Okay, so so that's essentially what, in order to bid on the project, those were the requirements that all bidders, companies needed to submit to submit their bid to the project. Spoke a little bit about the preparation of the bid documents. So going back into, now that we've received the 100% documents from GSP, the project architect, we have a quick review of project documents, plan, specifications. So you have the plans, the floor plans, the section cuts that make up the plans. And then specifications are basically the material, product data, the code requirements that the contractors need to adhere to, all that information make up plans and specifications. We spoke about how we review the scope of work and break it down to individual contracts, assign, we really try to explain what they all need to include in, what the bidders need to include in their proposals, trying to make sure that there's no scope, overlap, if you will. And that's what we face in the industry, making sure we don't buy the same thing twice. And so we try to spell that out as part of our bid preparation and their scope of work. We're also reviewing it, completing lists of drawings, making sure that the list of drawings and the actual plans and specifications are accountable. Everybody has the same plans and specs. We're including sample contracts so that the bidders know what kind of potential contract they are entering into with the owner so that there's no surprises there. We're listing scheduling information. The bidders need to know when their work will occur, so that they can plan their manpower accordingly on when they will fit into their schedules. So that information is something that we were involved with as well. Quality control requirements, what are the expectations on the projects? Outline those. Project safety requirements, you see, if you've been by the site, you see the hard hats and the safety glasses on and all that stuff. Make sure, that kind of information on a public project needs to be entered in, and all bidders need to know that, so that way there's no surprises when they they're submitting their project their proposals. Submittal requirements, basically day-to-day project management requirements on the project. So all that goes into what we call the preparation of the bid document, and and amongst all of that work that I just discussed is, we're contacting prospective bidders, trying to really engage them in the project, competing for their business, making sure that this, the goal is this is the only project going on in the state. We all know that's not reality, but that's our task and charge. So that's a little bit about the preparation of the bid document. So I think moving on down the list, I'm not sure if I'm addressing everything here, and please stop me if there are questions.
I have a question, because I think it's a good place to ask it. So you guys prepare the estimate that we worked around with council, and now you're getting ready to prepare the bid documents using now newly designed, using the designs as Henry described that process. What had changed between what you estimated and what you bid? Square footage, for example, is one of the things you said. So could you go through the things that you knew changed and what they were?
Yeah, the square footage is one item. When you get to the construction documents, you get finalized details. The window sizing, the specifications, there are standards of requirements that are necessary to put those final budgets together. So there's many things that we could discuss, but it's the final section cut details. Of the cladding systems and all the backup material that go into generally are in line with the estimates and budgets up to that point. But I don't know how much more deep I need to. I don't know if that answers the question or
is Councilor, do you mean between what was shared, which was kind of conceptual, a conceptual budget during the time the council approved this deal? What changed between that and when Shield Sexton had construction documents that they were taken out to the street? Was that what you meant?
What shared in the specification you gave, in the six pages of specification drawings that you gave Shield Sexton that they were able to estimate off of versus what they were then bidding for? So does that make sense?
Yeah. Kevin, do you want to kind of take on the difference? We kind of touched on this a little bit yesterday, but the difference between what you're pricing out conceptually during conceptual renderings and versus now, it's a year and a half later plus, and you've gotten to construction documents and interior design is part of that.
Sure. I mean, in general terms, it's not like you can look at one thing and say what changed. I mean, you're talking about six pages of 8.5 by 11 inch piece of paper with no specifications, no real renderings, and saying, hey, what does a hotel like this typically cost? So to be able to compare the two without saying, well, there was no crown molding or there were no bigger rooms like Paul Corey talked about, or the mechanical systems, it wasn't like it changed from one thing to another, because initially there was nothing. So it isn't like it changed. There was nothing designed. There was nothing really planned out. Marriott wasn't involved. They hadn't been out to Bethesda to meet with them. It hadn't taken on the name yet, and things were very preliminary. So there's everything changed in essence, because there was no carpet picked. There was no size of the rooms picked. There were no mechanical systems picked. The exterior elevations hadn't been picked. So in reality, the entire job became the Hotel Carmichael at the bidding stage. But prior to that, it was just a concept of what happens if we put a hotel on this piece of land that is, you know, based on other boutique hotels that are built across the country and right here in central Indiana. I don't know if that answers your question without going in detail to say how much did we have in for carpet. You know, we could go back and compare those two to say here's what it actually cost and here's what it was initially. But that would be a long meeting to go line item by line item and look at each one. But in general terms, there was no design yet. There was no design development. There was no schematic design. It was just an early concept of what could a hotel like this cost if we put it on this general site.
And is it also fair to say that another thing that changed is instead of pricing a conceptual hotel based on ironworks that got done in 2015 and imagining how costs have risen, you've had a year to a year and a half. I mean, some of these packages, interior design packages, are going out in like millwork flooring. Some of those packages are being first put out on the street in mid-2019 compared to, you know, late 2017 first estimates. So what changed is a combination of now this thing, you know, there's a hallway. So Sheila Sexton goes, what's a nice hallway? And then we figure out how much molding is in the ceilings, right? Then Sheila Sexton figures out how nice the tile is and the pattern. That's something that they wouldn't have priced out initially. But also 2 years of a crazy market. I mean, that the combination of those two things is what's changed.
Okay. And a great example of that. Sorry, go ahead,
Counselor. That's okay. Go ahead, Kevin.
Well, I mean, a great example of that time period that changed, there was a lot of work going on in central Indiana. There were hundreds of articles written about the lack of electricians, the lack of drywallers, and the of concrete tradesmen. So there was a lack of field force available during that time, but there were also tariffs going on. Steel prices were going up 30-40% in that 18-month to two-year period. So I was talking specifically about what changed on the drawings, but there was a lot of things that changed from mid-2017 to when we had the interior drawings in mid-2019. So there's a lot that changed in the economy during that time period. No different than the economy right now, which right now, if a project was bidding, you'd get great pricing. In 2018, yeah. It was a little less, a little higher pricing than it is right now.
When the city was building the Palladium, there, that was a different time, and the market was flat. But when this hotel was being built, everything was just exploding.
Understood. Right. You've got the bid packages developed, and you're ready to send them out. Talk about how you did that. There's four different bid packages. How you did that, what the results were, what you did then, because they started coming in higher than you thought, what was done to then try to, what discussions were had, what actions were taken to try to then try to figure out if we can get the cost down.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and answer that. So I'd like to just discuss the process of yeah, we got the bid package prepared and ready to issue, and so everybody's on the same pages. There's a public notification that notifies bidding community that the project is ready to be issued for or out to bid, and so that needs to occur 48 hours in advance of the actual documents being issued to the local print shops, online bidding software, if you will. So that notification went out to local newspapers. And then after that 48 hours, we issued those documents to, like I said, the local print shops and on our internal websites, bidding softwares, and other national publications to get the word out of that this project is live now. In those documents, there's a note for a pre-bid conference that generally was about a week after the documents went out. It was conducted at, and all this is rhyme true for the multiple packages that went out, so the same process. The pre-bid conference enabled the bidders of interest an opportunity to discuss with the ownership team, this construction manager, the design architect, to ask questions more in detail after their initial review of the project so that they could have the information they need to develop bids. So essentially the time span for these bids was approximately 3 to 4 weeks that the bidders were enabled to develop their bids. Bids were due at the city hall. And then on that same day, they were opened in a public Carmel Redevelopment Commission meeting. The bid results were announced publicly. After that meeting,
hey, Ryan, real quick, I just want to comment on the bids coming in, these public bids. I just want to make sure everybody understands that when we receive these bids, you know, these are, they're accurate because there's four or five bidders that are bidding each one of these trade packages. They're timely. They're the current market price, and they're really market driven. So I just want to make sure everybody understands that these are sealed bids that come in from multiple contractors bidding these jobs. That they're going after it as aggressively as they can to try to win the work because they want to build the project. So these are timely, accurate, and current market driven prices. And obviously, as I said before, in a frothy economy. Sorry, Ryan, go ahead.
No, Ryan, can you mention how separating the bids into multiple packages allowed Shield to spend more time on getting out bidders for individual items?
Yeah, and so, you know, part of that was a schedule driven, and like Henry mentioned, long lead items were essentially bid package one. Items consisted of the structural steel and the building shell, the concrete foundations, the concrete deck, the structural steel. And so by doing that, we were recognizing everything that we've been mentioning previous to this, escalating costs of construction, the decision will be and having the completion date in mind, as mentioned earlier. But it also afforded the design to get finalized, to get further along in the design, and an ability to earmark, as much interest in the project as possible. So the last thing we wanted to do is to issue an incomplete set of plans to the bidders, and that just essentially escalates the cost even more with incomplete details and plans. What bidders would do then, if there's not the sufficient information, they start including allowances, essentially driving up the cost of their bids, and we don't want that. So by allowing that design to come to fruition and be completed and breaking it up into those package, as Henry suggested, it allowed that design to be completed while we were addressing the longer lead items.
Ryan, can you talk about how we included add alternates in our bidding to kind of prepare us for a value engineering conversation?
Correct, yeah. So realizing the escalation of the costs in the earlier bid packages, we were able to create alternates, add alternates on items that, basically form the bidding documents by creating the alternates within the bid forms. For bidders to look at and to identify items that aren't necessarily required or needed, if you will, but to mold the specifications or the bid forms for this.
So a couple examples of that is we were going to do a brick facade on the outside. So at the point that they're going out and doing the public bidding, they're bidding those with: contractor, tell me what you're going to charge for the brick facade. Tell me what you're going to charge for EFAS, which should be less. And so the bids can come back and we can see the two and actually, you know, instead of doing just brick and seeing, oh, how do we deal with that? We have our options presented to us at the point of bidding. Another option is bidding something out where we have a marble floor versus a nice porcelain tile floor. Instead of trying to scramble later when we only bid what was initially designed, which was the stone, the marble, Shield Sexton separates these packages into add alternates so we can have the ability to choose later where we can cut costs but still look good. It's just an example. Sorry, go ahead.
I think we were at the point that once the bids were received, we took them into consideration to make sure that the scopes, the proposals were complete, included everything that needed to be included for the scopes that were outlined in the project documents. Once we felt comfortable that those conditions were met, an award recommendation was made to the project or the ownership team, and at that point, the ownership team reviewed it and approved it or rejected it based on the outcome. The approval then went in front of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission meeting in a public forum that then became ratified into a future contract. And so from that point, the contract became live and the work, the contract deliverables, the contract execution and the insurances came active at that point after the ratification process at the meeting there.
Yeah. What trade-offs did occur in this as a result of the bidding process?
Yeah, one of the larger items was the change in, and I think Paul Corey mentioned it yesterday, the HVAC system, a more robust system to something that Paul sees in his facilities quite frequent, what we call a VRF system, if you will. We don't need to go into those details, but that was a large one. Henry's mentioned.
Was that around $800,000, $750,000 in terms of quantifiable change that we made?
Correct. Yeah, that was a large one. There was a lot.
Increase to the budget. Am I hearing increase to the budget?
No, as a decrease.
It was
What was bid out initially was this kind of a really nice system. And then afterward, you get into this thing where once you're so far along and you have to pay money to redesign something. So we actually paid a little bit of money to redesign the HVAC system, but ultimately save us about $750,000.
Okay, thank on that you. Project. I just want to make sure. Okay, sorry, go ahead with the other trade-offs.
Yeah, there was some openings that were just essentially a manufacturer change, that the detailing and design behind that was not sacrificed, but it was just a manufacturing change. There were some roofing type issues from a plate roof to a shingled roof. and then there's a lot of what we call in going through this process, a lot of behind the scenes type of things. How do the electrical wires get to point A to point B? And there's different types of either a pipe or what we call empty cable. So those types of things that the general public never sees, but there's cost savings associated with that. So I know we've had a list of over 100 items, those types of items. Several of them consisted of finished type items. We talked about the branding, and so not everything was considered, but there was a very lengthy list of those types of items. So those
and
are
some of the big ticket items. Ryan, is obviously the brick on the exterior in the top four levels went to EFAS. The limestone and granite details went to Monarch Brick, which is still beautiful, and you can see it on the first two levels of the facade of the hotel today if you drive by it. It's these large bricks, and they still look really good, especially with the patterns in them. But it's not the same as what's on the Palladium. It's not limestone. Some of the details it still looks good, but it's not the same cost. That's where we turned. That's where we went with, porcelain tile on the first two levels of the hotel instead of marble. I mean, it's still quality, but it's not the higher level. We made several millions dollars, several million dollars of cuts during this process, while being cautious that at a certain point, you have your frame, you have your steel, you have your concrete, you know where your floors are, you generally know where your mechanical runs, you generally know where your electrical and your plumbing runs. And at a certain point, redesigning and engaging all those professionals again doesn't save you very much money. So I think everything that we could have done, we did. I will admit that one of the recommendations that Shield came back with is changing all the tile to carpet on the first two levels, and we did not make that change. We stayed with a porcelain tile.
So to summarize, for before we get to questions, and we'll move on, there's a couple items I can get to tonight that I'll push to tomorrow. But we had a $40 million estimate. We come up with a total of $58.5 million in bids. So what's your shaking?
No.
Your, are you talking construction versus soft cost now? Is that
yes.
Okay? So
yes.
$58.5 million total budget. Let me get my terminology right. So we have a gap. What in percentages caused the gap? What percent was due to a hot market? You know, labor being more than you expected, fewer bidders than you expected because it's a public bidding process. There were changes made from what we thought might be happening in the estimate to what happened in reality. There are square footage changes. Break down the difference in the $18.5 million, where this difference came from.
And Shield can only speak to a part of this, only to the hard costs, not some
That's
of the
okay. We'll start with hard costs. How's that? And make it that easier.
So I'll start, and I'll do my best, and I'll hit on a couple things. Is that okay?
And Kevin, the hard cost estimate first was 28.5. Is that what we determined last night off the top of my head? And then the hard cost bid was what then?
We're at 42 today.
Thank you. So I guess for your part then, yeah, talk about that, the difference there.
I mean, there's a lot of different items, right? There was the square footage increase, and if you just do that alone, it adds up to over $2.5 million just by the increase in square footage. You know, during this time period, and there's a bunch of studies that we've said before, and I think they've been in the IBJ, that luxury hotels during that same time period went up 37%. A good example, we talked about trying to get packages out early, and I mentioned this yesterday, that steel, we did put a steel package out in February of 2000, and I'm trying to get to it in my notes here, sorry, real quick. In February of 2018.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you have that note in front of you, Ryan? And that came back in 40% higher when we bid it then in October and November of 2018. So just that package alone went up 40%. So to go through and say, hey, what's each one? It would never add up from 28 million to 42 million because there isn't that many things that went up in price. But the design, and remember I talked about that there was no design when that price was. So if you took this same set of drawings that we have today and took those back to 2017, it wouldn't have been $28 million. So to track the $28 million to the 42 isn't necessarily a good exercise because this job that we built, the hotel that you see in front of you today, well, not in front of you, where Ryan is, but that you see being built, would not have been $28 million in 2017. That's just not the case. Would it have been $34, $35 million? Maybe, but it wouldn't have been $28 million. And so, you know, the escalation during that time doesn't account for the difference between those two, the design being created, the hotel being created. You know, and I'm going to sound like an architect here a little bit, but that hotel kind of coming to life and becoming what the Hotel Carmichael is today is what happened. And that makes up a lot of that. And you know, is it $6 or $7 million? Probably, but it's hard to pinpoint exactly what that is because we're not going back to 2017 and estimating the set of drawings, the interior drawings, the Feinstein Club, the elevations, like we built and what bid out in 2018 and 2019. Is that?
I could probably speak to the soft cost counselor if you'd like me to.
Yes.
Paul Corey had another engagement, so he thought that he's actually offline now. So the soft cost is really a combination of two things. The first is actual goods that we're receiving, right? FF&E, furniture, fixtures, equipment, things that initially we thought in 2017, right, in 2017, there's general, we think per room, probably this is it. And then you go and you pick it out, you go and you try to get the best deal as your procurement company goes out to China and the Czech Republic and Mexico to try to figure out these things. A large portion, obviously, comes from China. And just like the steel tariffs, a large portion of the FF&E hit this, the tariffs hit that FF&E. And so a lot of that soft cost, yeah, it those are actual goods that did go up by quite a lot because of various, both the time frame change and tariffs. There's also, and I talked about this to my presentation to council, we negotiated a deal where every dollar that the Redevelopment Commission puts in, it gets largely reimbursed as an advance. So as an example, I think initially when this was presented to council, we believed that this deal was going to have $400,000 in fees, in consultant fees. We end up having almost $2 million in various fees. That's legal fees. That's, you know, bringing on someone like Les Olds to help with the project because he was just tremendous at everything. A big contribution to the team. And so where, let's call it a less forthcoming redevelopment commission could have easily taken all those costs of bringing on those kind of consultants, expending extra legal fees, and just said, hey, this is just part of what redevelopment commissions do. We just, that's just the cost of doing business. I think we could have easily, reasonable minds could have disagreed on whether an extra $100,000 or an extra really, you know, $1 million in legal fees is a redevelopment commission cost or is a tag to this hotel. Okay, well, we negotiated with PEDCOR to get almost every dollar that we put in over and above the original amount reimbursed to the redevelopment commission. And so every Les Olds hour, every legal fee, every single dollar that we could possibly tag on to this project to stick into this $58.5 million bucket, we did so that we can get almost all of it reimbursed. And so the rise in the soft cost is a combination of, yeah, plates today cost more than plates 3 years ago. Getting, you know, multiple millions of dollars of stuff from China as tariffs were hitting, really an inopportune time. All that costs went up. But it's also that we put every single soft cost we possibly could into the $58.5 million bucket. It's more of a sticker shock, but ultimately that's more money the Redevelopment Commission is getting back. I can honestly say that there's not a single dollar over the course of literally the last 4 years during me, during my predecessor, that went into planning this hotel, not a single dollar that's not in this giant bucket that we're mostly getting reimbursed back.
Thank you. Okay, it's 7:28. I want to do is open this up for questions to the council. First up is the Finance Committee itself. Bruce Kimball.
Thank you, Madam Chair. A lot of good information. I've got a couple questions, but let me limit it to one. Being a public, we talked about this as a public bid process. How does that differ from, let's say, the private sector going out? Are there checks and balances to ensure that a bid package, we had four bid packages, weren't developed to favor one contractor over another?
I think, Kevin, if you could kind of, again, summarize things that the statute requires that you do, because remember, we ultimately could have, well, maybe I'll give this a try and then you can supplement if I miss anything. We ultimately had a decision to make. Do we bid this publicly or do we not? Because of the structure that I discussed earlier, because it was technically the private hotel that had the contract with Shiel Sexton, there was an opportunity to bid this privately. But because of how much taxpayer money, how much bonds went into this deal, we made the decision that instead of doing this, you know, privately in the dark, we were going to run everything through public meetings everything through transparency. If you want to see the bid documents and the awards today, it's all on Laserfish under the Redevelopment Commission, under the Hotel Carmichael. We're going to publicly bid it. And so where we gain on that transparency, we sacrifice in cost. I think Kevin said yesterday it's about 10 to 15%. When the market is booming and you're a painter, and honestly, you're hiring whoever you can, you may be just as good of a painter, but you can't handle the bond, the surety that comes with the deal. Maybe you're doing your best to hire whoever you can, and you can handle the cost of the bond, but you are not signing up for that E-Verify program. So there's three hotels being built. Two of them don't have an E-Verify requirement. By the way, you have to pay for each person to get E-Verified. So there's a cost to complying with E-Verify from just an administrator standpoint, and a what is our labor force that's doing our painting? We're not bidding on the Carmichael. Why would we do that? Ultimately, those requirements are state statute. And so we follow the state statute in doing those. Generally what you get is a company that's more established that can meet those various requirements will come in and we'll do the work. And it's going to be amazing. And if it's not amazing, you call the surety. But there is some sacrifice in cost, and there's a lot of sacrifice in who's even going out. And so, you know, a private company, a private hotel will get four elevator bids. We get one. That's just the deal. And so I think that is essentially a summary. We followed the process. It was fully transparent. We sacrificed costs. But because of the large public funding component here, including this meeting itself that's going on, after we followed public requirements, public biddings, we're having a three-night meeting. Imagine if we never followed public bidding requirements. It may have lasted a few more nights.
Just to add on to that, and I think this might be part of what you were asking, is what ensures that we're getting the same bid and doesn't favor one contractor over another? Was that kind of part of what you were asking?
Yes.
So what we have is a lot of things. A, we have state statute that we have to follow as a public bidding entity. But then we have our drawings, our specifications, and as Ryan talked about earlier, our scope of work and our bid packages. So we level the playing field, and all of those contractors that are bidding it are bidding the same set of documents, the same set of specifications, and the same set of scope of work that we produce, so that when they bid, we're getting an apples-to-apples comparison to each contractor, and we're getting, other than the elevators, as Henry has mentioned, we're getting multiple bids in each bid package. So it isn't just four bids. We're getting 60, 70 bids for a job like this, because we're getting four or five steel bids, three or four electrical bids, and they're all bidding the same exact set of documents that they have to build to by contract. I hope that answers that.
Thank you, Miles Nelson. Do you have a question?
Madam Chair, I do. Thank you so much for the opportunity. We're fiduciary stewards for the city and the taxpayers. And what I'm hearing is that there was an estimate that was so low as compared to what ultimately this project is costing. And it seems like that because it's a public project, you know, it blows up. And because the ROI is going to be so low that no private company would have wanted to build anything to this level. And so, you know, and so again, I'm going to reiterate the fact that what we decide here is going to be setting precedent on future projects. And that's why it's so important. And I appreciate your time, all of your time tonight. But the question then is, what can we do to ensure on future projects that the estimate isn't so much lower than what we ultimately bid on and what we ultimately pay for as taxpayers? Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. I think there's kind of three parts to that question. The first is a comment about low ROI. And I want to make sure that everyone listening understands that initial estimates had us making 6-7% return on equity upon stabilization. But developers want to get 10 and 11. And they can go to South Beach and they can build a giant condo project and get 12-15% return on equity. So why would they come here and build one that gets them 6 or 7? That's one. Two, right, you don't get a return on equity when you spend more money on the facade to make it beautiful and architecturally significant. But when we're doing a landmark hotel and the first Marriott Autograph Hotel in the state of Indiana in our central core, that's the reason for public private partnerships like this. The third answer is, I want to make sure that everyone understands that even though the costs rose, the ROI was not affected. We talked earlier about this hotel was going to be a $25 million loan, or let's call it $25.5 million loan, and then everything else was being put in from the city, right? $18 million in bonds being put in from the city. So when you're talking about return on equity, when you're talking about your ROI, you're thinking about what revenue comes in and what are you paying out. What you're paying out is your debt service on that loan. And you're paying out, you know, the cost of operations, you're paying out salaries, blah, blah, blah. But generally, the big expense is that loan. And that loan never changed. What changed was the Redevelopment Commission put in more money. And it's getting that money reimbursed out of profit. And so I just want everyone to understand that even though the cost of the hotel changed, the revenue going to the owners, the profit going to the owners is not changing because the loan amount is staying the same. The only thing that's really happening is now that money that's going to the owners, instead of as originally planned when this was first presented, that the Redevelopment Commission was paying its share on the loan to benefit Petcor. What's happening now is Petcor is taking a majority of that money and paying it right back to the Redevelopment Commission. So it's a temporary advance, and it's not affecting an ROI. It's not affecting the income and the payback that that project is making. And to reiterate my point yesterday, if we're building a garage, I can tell you exactly what it's going to cost. And it's not going to cost me a lot of money to get you that estimate. If you're building the Palladium, you got to put in millions of dollars of design fees to tell you exactly what it's going to cost. If you're building a unique in the universe building, the Hotel Carmichael, I got to pay millions of dollars to tell you exactly what it's going to cost. And I'm happy to take input on a future project like this from each counselor. Please let me know exactly how much money you want me to spend. But I remember these conversations at the Redevelopment Commission when Corey Meyer was taking this project to council, where the commissioners were not happy spending a single dollar on a project they did not know was going to get approved. And so, again, that's a philosophical question. I think everyone has a different answer on how much do you spend on something to design it when the council may just vote it down? Is it $10? Is it $1 million? I think everyone has a different answer.
Thank you. Councillor Worrell.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My question is to put a fine point on the first part of my question, then I'll ask the second part of my question. It seems to me that if we were in a hot market when all the architectural design was done and you had construction documents, I'm looking for clarity. It really wasn't a surprise where the bids came in. Every blaring headline, where a lot of the talking points that the bids have come in higher, and I would agree the bids came in higher than the estimate, but it really wasn't a surprise where the bids were coming in a hot market, right? I can imagine it would not have been. And therefore I wonder, there's a tool out there that is used for public entities where there's a cost guarantee by the construction manager. And so I would just like the first part of my question to be applied to, would that have helped us at all with having some kind of a guarantee from the construction manager. I'm going to assume you know what I'm talking about, that tool, that I don't have to explain it.
Kevin, can you help with that?
Sure. So, you know, what Council Royale is talking about is there's a couple different types of delivery methods of construction contracts. One is a construction manager of agent, as agent is what this contract is. And there's one that's called a construction manager as constructor. And then there's design bid build. A construction manager as contractor, what you're alluding to, is where the construction manager assigns a guaranteed maximum price. And they become responsible for that. I can tell you beyond a shadow of doubt, the cost of this job would not have changed one bit whether this was a construction manager as agent or a construction manager as constructor or a construction or a design bid build. Because in any one of those cases, we would have gone back out to the market and bid the job. And we would have got the same basic bids in from about the same contractors, and the job would have been bid out. So we wouldn't have guaranteed a price back in June of 2018 or June of 2017. We wouldn't have guaranteed a price until we had 80, 90% complete construction drawings when the interior designer was done. And if you recall, Henry mentioned a little while ago that this was phased. So when we bid out that first phase, we didn't have the interior design drawings yet. So that would have been an allowance that we wouldn't have even had the opportunity to even do a budget on yet because we didn't have the drawings. So whether this went construction manager or construction manager as agent, where our fiduciary responsibility, our contractual responsibility is to the Carmel Redevelopment Commission and PEDCOR, or whether it was as a construction manager, as contractor, it wouldn't have changed the cost of this job, because the cost of this job is in the light fixtures, it's in the woodwork, it's in the windows, it's in the paint, it's in the drywall, it's in all the things that make up this job. And that job would have been the same regardless of what the contract delivery method is. The fees that go associated with each one of those contracts are really the changes in 0.25%, and it wouldn't have made a big difference. The difference is who assumes that risk. And in this case, it's how soon does the construction manager assume that risk? The other thing that should be noted as far as this is, you know, not that long ago, 4 or 5 years ago, the state of Indiana, no public entities were allowed to use construction manager as constructor. That was for private entities only. And in 2017, there was no city or municipality in the state of Indiana that had used construction manager as constructor. The only people that had used it were public universities. This was new. It would have been the first project. And I think being on the cutting edge of things is great. And obviously Carmel is on the cutting edge of a lot of things, but I don't think this would have been a great risk to say, we want to be the first project and we want it to be not a cookie cutter, a days in type of hotel. We want it to be something special to say, this is the first project that we want to go out as a construction manager, as constructor. And I know that's a lot of terminology, and I apologize if I've lost anyone in that, but just to kind of recap real quick, the cost of the drywall wouldn't have changed on either delivery method because it would still been a public bid. The cost of the electrical work wouldn't have changed. And this would have been the first project going in the city, in the state of Indiana, as a municipality or city going out to do a construction manager as constructor. And I don't think that would have been in the best interest of PEDCOR or the Redevelopment Commission or the city of Carmel.
If I could just chime in for just 1 second. The Redevelopment Commission is doing 2 construction projects right now. And the other one is a wall. We're building a wall and we're using CM at risk with a guaranteed price. It's a wall. This thing was a unique to the universe project. And as Kevin said, no one had done this before. And so we went with the method that has always been used, which is CMA. And Shiel Sexton won't say this because they do both projects, but when you're doing construction manager as your agent, they're out there helping you out against the prime contractors that are bidding this out. And when you're using CM at risk, they don't want to go above a certain number. They're at risk. And so there's a slight adverse relationship between the two, even though the statute won't exactly say that. So you're hiring more people to watch your CMC as owner's reps. We trust Shiel. We went with Shiel as CMA.
Thank you.
Jeff, was there a part B?
No, I combined those two,
okay,
knowing we're in a hot market and the CMA.
Thank you. I just want to clarify. I appreciate that. Next to the rest of the council, Adam Austin.
Yes, quick question. I don't know if it really goes with the bidding process, but Henry, you mentioned most of this money that was pounded that will be repaid to the CRC, reimbursed. Are any of those projections being adjusted considering the difficulties that the hotel market has had now after the COVID-19 crisis? Are you doing any adjustment to your projections and how it might affect the timeline for reimbursement?
Hey, Adam, might I suggest we hold on that because we're going to ask Henry to come into the council meeting and actually talk about revised projections?
That's fine.
Would that be okay with you for a council meeting?
Just a question for some point. When he said that, it was in my head, but we can answer that some other time.
Yeah, I think we all have those questions, and I'm just trying to keep this as tight as I can to the hotel development, financing, and governance related to that. Do you have another question regarding that you'd like to ask?
No, that's okay for this evening.
Okay, thank you, sir. Mm-hmm. I think Laura Campbell had to leave here a couple minutes ago. Not hearing her jump in, I think that's right. Tony Green, do you have any questions?
Yes, Henry, I get a question. The council approved this sometime around August or September 2017. And when was the bid actually put out?
We had four different bid packages put out in late 2018 or in early to mid 2019.
All right, so there was a kind of a substantial delay between when the council approved the project and when the bids went out. Is there a reason for that?
You're designing a unique to the world hotel from scratch, and it takes a long time to put something like that together. At the time council approved this thing, we didn't have interior designers hired at that point. So, I mean, we went full speed ahead to get ready to put this out to bid as soon as we possibly could, to the point where we split up the packages and went out for the steel and the concrete, you know, months before we went out for the interior stuff. But it takes a time to design a project like this. As much as I yell at the architects, they can only design as fast as they can do it.
So part of the delay, like you said, was, it took time to get, the specific designs put in place so you knew exactly what to go out to bid with.
It's not a delay. It's just the process of preparing. I don't like the connotation that comes with the word delay. This is the process that it takes to prepare a building and construction drawings to bid out that building.
All right. So kind of going back to the examples you gave between the parking garage and the hotel, a parking garage is more, the likelihood of it being passed, there's a greater likelihood. People are more inclined to spend more money on the design on the front end. Is that what you said for a parking garage normally?
I can ask Shiel right now how many parking garages they've built in the last 3 years, and they can probably tell me 15. So literally the Redevelopment Commission built five parking garages or something in the last few years. I know the cost of a parking garage It's $20 a space. Literally today, I can tell you how much it's going to cost. $20 a space, $23,000 a space. We're designing $23,000 a space. That gets you a garage. This thing is unique to the world, completely nowhere else, designed from scratch hotel. You got to spend millions of dollars to get to final design to fully know what it's going to cost.
All right, so you have to have a full design to know exactly what it was going to cost. But we didn't get that design until late 2018, early 2019, right before it went out to bid. Okay, so
it went out to bid on the interiors and on some of the remaining site work in mid-2019. Mid-2018 is when the long lead items went out to bid. So we're designing parts of this. We designed the outside. We know how much steel we need from the engineers. That goes out as a bid package while you're working on the remaining stuff. You don't need to have how much crown is in a room designed at the same time as you need to know how much steel you're ordering from China. And so we separated these things to go as quick as possible.
All right. So kind of going back to when the city council looked at the proposal for the hotel during the summer of 2017, you know, we spent 2.5-3 months, you know, going through lots and lots of meetings. All the councilors participated a great deal, asking lots and lots of questions. So you're saying at the end of that process, after the 2.5 months and a lot of meetings in which 5 council members voted up for the hotel, thinking it's worth the risk, what we were voting on, we really had no idea what the cost was at that time. And we wouldn't know what the cost was because the money wasn't spent in the front end to get an accurate picture, you know, because, again, there was a likelihood that the hotel might not pass, like you said, by the council. So there wasn't a lot of upfront money put into the design until it was certain the council would approve it. So going back to those 2.5 months of meetings that the council went through, when ultimately we approved the project, we really had no clue, or it was a very rough estimate of what the hotel would cost at that time.
Yes. Yesterday, I think we discussed at length that my predecessor, Corey Meyer, she presented the best thing that she could have presented at the time. She got an architect. The architect, you know, put out schematics, put out drawings, and Shiel Sexton, a company that built the last few boutique hotels, including the Ironworks, put out costs. My predecessor took that to council. If you don't think that she did enough, I think she did, but I'm not going to speak for some. I wasn't there at the time. The market exploded since then. And if what you're saying is you voted against this hotel to begin with. So if you're saying that you would have wanted her to spend $3 million on design before she brought this thing to you for you to vote against it, I understand your position. I think she did the best she could.
No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is
that's what it would have
cost.
There
were five council members who voted for this. And I'm thinking they had some, at least the impression, that the $40 million was $40 million, not just a really rough estimate that wouldn't have any certainty about the number until, 10, 11, 12, 13 months later. So I'm good with I'm just surprised that the other council members, after all the due diligence, all the meetings and all the questions that were asked, you know, voted on a project that was based on really rough estimates. You know, that's what I'm just, and based on what you're telling me, and I completely understand why. No one wanted to spend $3 million up front if the project was going to fail. I mean, that makes complete sense. You know, but it's hard for me to believe the 5 council members who voted for the hotel in September of 2017 were voting on it based on this, knowing that it's just really rough estimates on the cost of the hotel.
It's a combination of what Corey was working with and the fact that the construction costs exploded, that those estimates were based on non-publicly bid project, and we did a publicly bid project. I think that she was doing the best that she could. No one could have predicted this market exploding, and I think that we dealt with this issue yesterday. I'm not sure what more I can say on this topic.
All right. I'm done.
Thank you, sir. Councilor Hannon?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just two quick questions. One is, I think you can answer pretty quickly back to sort of organizational structure. So PEDCOR functionally at the end of sort of a waterfall for revenue owns 50% of this hotel. Is that correct?
When all is said and done, PEDCOR and the city are 50-50 partners.
Okay. So what was PEDCOR's skin in the game? What was their capital contribution to get 50% of this hotel ultimately?
PEDCOR started out on a piece of farmland and built City Center from scratch with a combination of city incentive and its own money. PEDCOR did this in the middle of the worst recession we've had, until now.
Director Metesky, it's a simple question.
And continued to do this.
What was the
PEDCOR has? I'm sorry. That's the answer to your question. PEDCOR has saved this site from day one for the landmark hotel in the city. Has not used it for anything else. This was the deal that was struck. 50-50 ultimately as a partnership. I'm not sure how. What else I can do to answer that question?
Simple technical question. So was their contribution the land? Was that their contribution for 50%? Or was there something else? That was a simple question.
No, it wasn't the land. The project paid $3 million for that land, and PEDCOR took that money and reinvested it back into City Center.
So PEDCOR put no capital contribution in?
Well, I mean, you could say that they carried the cost of that land for 20 years. They paid taxes on that land for 20 years. And they had the opportunity cost of not doing anything on that land and surviving as an entity to build City Center around it. You could dismiss, bringing something like Cake Bake to City Center and say, well, that would have happened anyway. I'm not sure. PEDCOR has built the Nash, all of the buildings, City Center, PEDCOR has invested across the street. PEDCOR brought their headquarters here. PEDCOR built City Center on a farm from scratch and held on to that land for the perfect hotel site for 20 years. And that hotel was envisioned from the beginning. And so I came into that deal structure, but I fully support it. And I appreciate that we had PEDCOR as a partner in this deal. And if we had three more PEDCORs, our city would be rivaling some of the amazing cities in Europe.
Okay, thank you. Question number two, I would just like to come back to Councilor Finkham's question. And this probably would involve Kevin Hunt again, which is to jump from 28.5 as the initial estimate to 40 for hard costs, what would be a reasonable allocation of that based upon either increase in construction costs versus essentially not having any of the design features at the time that was initially put together? Kevin said on a couple occasions that it was just a concept. We've said it's a loose estimate, et cetera. It seems like the bulk of that jump from 28.5 to 40 million was we simply didn't have the data to be able to make those design decisions. And then, in addition to that, a couple things that Mr. Corey said yesterday that caught my ear, and unfortunately, I guess he's not on it. One, again, Councilor Finkham has addressed that the initial square footage in this sort of concept mock-up was not correct. It got increased by 7,000 or something.
But it evolved, correct.
Yeah, but the other thing that he said that was sort of shocking is he said the Feinstein thing was out there. So was the Feinstein Club not in the original design, or were there no details in the Feinstein
Club? No, the Feinstein Club was in the design. I think my guess, again, I wasn't here at the time, but my guess is when those things got, when Sheil Sexton put dollars to the Feinstein Club, it was what would be a nice space, public space like that in a hotel. The Feinstein Club is grand, and I look forward to the public enjoying that amazing asset that we're going to have in our city.
So again, could I get Kevin Hunt to talk a bit about the Feinstein Club and how that evolved from the initial concept to the final bid?
Sure. And it's kind of, you've asked me a couple questions there, and I'll do my best to answer both of them. The one was back to Councillor Finkham's allocation. It's tough to say exactly what that is. This isn't a be able to compare apples to apples, because you can't do that. But if I had to say how much of this was we didn't have a design and now we have a design, and how much of this was market escalation, the best thing I can go to is how much the steel price went up, which was about 40%, how much that precast went up, which was about 17%, and how much we know that luxury hotel costs went up during that time frame, which was 37%. So when I take all of those things in, plus a few other, when we look at the commodities market and what steel is going for and what copper is going for and those types of things, and compare hard data to hard data during those time frames, you know, it probably is somewhere in the 35 to 40% of this was, you know, a market conditions from that, you know, basically 2 year period. And the other was, you know, the other 65 to 60% was just, hey, we didn't have a design and now we have what has been created. That is the Hotel Carmichael that's been designed, that the interior design is complete, and that the, you know, the facades match in, you know, equal what is next door at the Palladium and in the, and everything around it. So it's somewhere in that range, but it's hard to say exactly what that is because we're not comparing apples to apples. The second half of that question about the Feinstein Club, you know, as Henry said, this was not designed at the time. It was basically, hey, we're going to have an amenity space like you might have in any other hotel, you know, public space in a hotel where you can gather and hang out with friends and family. That's what that was envisioned at the time. And what it became was a performance space with acousticians involved and sound control. And as Henry's mentioned, a grand a space. So, you know, that to look at each one of those and say, how much was it then and how much is it now? There's a lot that goes into that, because the steel would have been the same. The exterior walls would have been the same. The power to the space probably did increase because of what's happening there. But how much was there before and how much is now is not really an easy comparison. But this isn't what you have in a common lobby of a common boutique hotel. This is something different and something unique. So to be able to put a hard, fast number on that, I can't, because we didn't put a hard, fast number on it at any given time, because you don't know what else is happening around that space, where it's going to be located in the building, how it's going to be designed. Henry, do you have anything to add to that? Or
no, I fully stand behind what my predecessor submitted to council.
So, Kevin, thank you. Particularly this split, even if it's a rough split of, you know, 65-35 is helpful. And then understanding that the Feinstein Club in particular was not, you know, it was, I don't want to say a misunderstanding, but it wasn't budgeted for what it eventually became. Is that fair to say?
That's fair to say. And I want to make sure everybody understands this is not, I'm not saying that that's the exact percentage. I'm basing that on what we know commodities went up, what we know luxury hotels went up, and what we know steel and precast went up during that time frame. I just want to make sure everybody understands that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Everybody, it's 8:00. We're a half hour past what I wanted to end, but I felt it was important to let all counselors ask their questions. Kevin Ryder's taking a pass and asking his final question. Tomorrow we'll start again at 6:00. We'll follow up with, or we'll start with a question that we didn't get done today, and because I want to better understand when construction of the hotel was started, how that was funded, and then we're going to go into asking the CRC, you know, what steps were taken to fund the gap now that we knew it went from a $40 million estimate to a $58.5 million final budget, including CRC dollars used, bonds, loans, any property transactions done with CDCs, and agreements in place with CDCs. We'll talk about that probably for a little bit. And then we'll also really want to understand the legal authority for the actions that were taken, because there have been a lot of questions from council and the community about those two items. Hopefully we'll end on time. And if not, we will again shore up and see if we need to add another meeting or even two next week, whatever the council and committee determine is needed to get the information that we need. So thank you, gentlemen, thank you. Being on the call tonight, and have a great night.
Thank you.